Yes,
true. Absolutely.
At this place,
yeah, I have kids, and then at some point they had a collection of these things. Yeah, and yes. I had to find a way to use them at the end. So.
Yesterday you had something on there, right?
A magnet?
No.
It's just the way when I put it. It's in the front of the phone, so because it hits. Because sometimes it would be, because with this, when I put it on the trumpet, I can see the but with this, I don't, so sometimes it's really cold.
Yeah,
I talk about all these small things, because, yeah, using things is something that then protecting the technique.
All right. Thank you all for coming. I hope you can hear me. Yeah, I think the sound is good in the room. So my name is Mazen Kerbaj. I'm a very, very bad trumpet player. I try to make the trumpet play what I want, because I cannot play what it wants. I'll talk a little bit about how I was introduced to the trumpet. It was when I was 17 or 18 years old. I never played music before. I'm a visual art, trained visual art artist. Accessory, I did this poster. A friend of mine used to listen to rock music and then to jazz and free jazz. And then a friend said, he's a guitar player, we still play together today. He said, I have a trumpet, do you want it? I said, sure. And this is how I inherited my first trumpet, not this one. And I wanted to play really free jazz, very loud, a little bit like Don Ader, the brother of Albert Ader. Quite a bad trumpet player, I have to admit. And directly, I was really disappointed by the instrument. So I had my wife back then, my first wife, who played saxophone, and I was very jealous of her things. She had so many things to do with her fingers and stuff, and this was really very limited. So three valves, and I'm not good in math, but I think there must be six or nine possibilities with this thing. No, not even nine. And then the sound, all of it comes from one side. It's very directional, so you don't have the thing with the saxophone where you have polyphonic things and things happening. So after 2-3 years of playing the trumpet, I abandoned it and moved to saxophone. I played for maybe 5 years tenor and soprano sax. I was a very bad imitation of Evan Parker on soprano sax, for those who know him. For those who don't, he's the specialist of the circular breathing on the saxophone. So I did it very badly on the saxophone, but then I brought it back to the trumpet when I came back to the trumpet. When I came back to the trumpet, and today when I play trumpet, the title of this talk is Trumpet is Perfect for This. I think it's the most perfect instrument for what I do with it today. One thing is about the music also is important, about the music I play. I come from free jazz, as I said, and mostly of so-called free improvised music or non-idiomatic improvisation. I know it doesn't have a sexy name, but it's a genre of music somehow, and it is based mostly on sound rather than notes or tones or pitches. Of course, pitches and tones can come in it, rhythm can come, even harmony, everything, but it's not necessary. So it's really very open, and it's very encouraged that every musician find his own vocabulary for the instrument he plays and create his own sounds, etc. So I really come from there. I'm really not, it wasn't a joke that I'm a bad trumpet player, so I don't know how to read music, I don't know how to name the tones, so I can do a tone, of course. But I have no clue what note this is. I'm sure many of you know, but I think I'm not interested. I think it's too late for me to start knowing these things. So over the years, I invented a lot of techniques. I discovered some by seeing other musicians doing it. I stole a lot of techniques from, it's an intelligent way to steal techniques. I steal from drummers and bass players, so nobody can make the relation between what I do and another trumpet player, for instance. But also I discover many techniques that are used by other trumpet players. So I will start with these techniques, the so-called extended techniques. I guess if some of you play contemporary music, many of these techniques are common now. It's called extended techniques, but they are common language. So for instance, breathing in the trumpet, in and out. Small sounds in the, like things you're not supposed to do. Etc. So many sounds that are more really rough sounds that you can, of course, combine in many ways. Of course, those who saw Peter Evans yesterday playing, he used many of these techniques in a fantastic way. Of course, many influences are from the European scene. Axel Dörner comes to mind, or Franz Halsinger, trumpet players that, if you don't know, you should check. Axel is really one of the pioneers of this all these small sounds and weird sounds to do on the trumpet. From there, I developed many other techniques that are quite unique because I was somehow I lived until 5 years ago in Beirut all my life, and when I discovered improv music and free jazz, it was only on CD. I never saw anybody doing it, and it was always a trick to put disc, and then I see on it trombone, drums, and piano, and I don't know who is doing what. It's really like so much different sounds, and this really pushed me to try and experiment with the trumpet. Also, I had this friend, and I said, this guitar player, Sharif Sahnawi, played a lot, not extended technique, but prepared guitar, so you know, like you put screwdrivers in the chords or playing with a fan, etc. And I saw this in videos of John Cage doing it in a piano, and I was very jealous because the trumpet looked really very austere and unpreparable. But then again, the trumpet, like any other instrument, is highly preparable, and actually is perfect. Again, it's perfect for this. So before going into the more extended preparation, with time, especially when talking and doing a talk about this, I managed to find three ways or three general ways to prepare the trumpet the way I do it. So one of them is to use the trumpet. It's more an alteration of the trumpet rather than a preparation. So it's changing the embouchure, playing without it, for instance, or adding something on it, or using, for instance, sax or small objects I will talk about. And so it's from both sides, so changing the way I send the air in it, or changing the way it goes out. Of course, the way it goes out, you have sourdines, you have, how do you call sourdines in English?
Mutes.
Yeah, yeah. So this is one that is a little bit familiar. Of course, I took the one really you use from the house. But I use much more many other things like tin cans or drum heads or what kind of loops. So I start with this sax mouthpiece. So it's one of the rare things I kept from the saxophone. Also with time I understood, so I told you I know nothing about the trumpet, but with time and talking with a lot of trumpet players, I learned little by little. So I learned it's a B-flat instrument maybe 10 years after I started playing it. And then after looking for the best sax mouthpiece, I understood the soprano is a B-flat, so it works much better than with a tenor mouthpiece. Also, I used to tape it with stuff and make sure there's no air, etc. With time, now I have really perfect, it looked like I bought it from somewhere, but it's the perfect match. So this makes it sound really like a soprano sax, or a weird soprano sax. Things you can remove things from the trumpet. One of them is the third slide or the first slide, you say. So when I remove this one, of course, if I press the first slide, the sound will come from here. This combined with circular breathing, I don't know if you're all familiar with circular breathing, the technique you use for didgeridoo usually, but that. Yeah, that was used on many instruments, European instruments later on. With this, I managed to create kind of patterns that create third sounds sometimes, so I will try to demonstrate a little bit. Behind. the pattern that is done. And here I can already talk a little bit about the music I make. So besides that it's improvised and working with sounds, I work a lot with rhythm or patterns or repetitive things. I also work a lot with percussion, so it's different from rhythm. We'll talk about it later. I think it was Cecil Taylor who said once that he thinks about the piano as a percussive instrument. I do the same with the trumpet, so most of my work is really in repetitive patterns or in percussive things rather than in melodic. I think what I did now was the most melodic I could manage to do, so please forgive me. Other things I use in the front of the trumpet again. So some people asked me, some people who were at the concert asked me, how do I get this high pitch? And it's a funny thing with trumpet players, especially at school or even later on with trumpet players, there's always this, how to say, this competition of who can get the highest sound. Of course, we all know this, we all blew our lips, etc. I think I'm not bad, but I'm not the champ with this thing. So it is what it is, but then I am actually the champ. If I cheat with this thing, I can really beat any trumpet player, you name it. Then when you blow it, when you overblow it, and you put it here, I mean, outside it doesn't have this high pitch. I always, when I'm doing the sound check, I make sure to show it to the sound engineer, because many times he thinks it's a feedback or something, and it will just go down with the thing. This thing, yeah, is crazy. I mean, the first time I arrived to this high pitch, I couldn't believe, and then I managed to master it, but it's really very rich. It's not about this sound only. And this goes for many of the things I do, so it took me time also to understand. It's something like the first 5 or 7 years was always searching for new sounds. But then I recognized that it's important to be very versatile with the sound, especially when I started traveling also, to have, like, this is my travel kit. It goes in this small box here. So it all goes in, and when I want to add something like that, I have to remove something like that. It's really very compact. But in Beirut, I used to have 2 big suitcases for every gig, and then bring everything. And so little by little, I just keep the thing I can use really extensively, and not to do one sound effect. So this is really also quite interesting. Again, it permits me to do something that's close to what Axel Dörner does on the trumpet, and I don't know how he does it. Yesterday, Peter was doing it also at some point, this like really hardcore noise, and you keep it for a while. It's very different, but it permits the same. Again, I will start from outside and then go in the trumpet, because you'll see the difference.
Thank you.
takes time, of course, to understand what things work and again, what is really only a sound effect and what could really be used as an instrument almost. Yeah, sometimes I even use like this guitar, I think, pitch pipe. So you can blow the three of them together, and then I discovered you can use the trumpet. And I know on a picture it looks ridiculous, but it works. I saw once a picture of me from the concert doing this, and somebody posted on Facebook. I let you imagine the comments. No, it's not the right way. This was the easiest thing, but then it went really very bad. So one other very, very big important thing I discovered or I use is playing with water in the trumpet. Of course, we all know we need to empty the water all the time because otherwise it makes this nasty and then I saw you yesterday, the people playing with the baroque thing, it's even worse, there's no water keys, they have to leave.
Yeah, yeah, well, see, like
I got scared in the beginning, but then I understood, like every... And with time I realized I sometimes like to play with the thing, and then I would wait while playing until there is enough saliva or condensation in it, and then I work with it. And little by little I discovered that actually, I like this effect, and I cannot use it only when there is too much saliva. So the easiest way was to have a bottle of water next to you, and then... So with time, I know how much water to put in this. Of course, of course, if I play a tone, it will sound horrible. Then I play it without the mouthpiece, and again I discovered really many possibilities on this thing, and for me when it's with water it's almost a different instrument. So the water and comes back, and the sound comes from here, and then when it passes you have this coming from here. So sometimes when I play it amplified I like to play it with two microphones, and you really have these two sounds coming together. And when you have this pop up, then this one begins to make a variation. It's not anymore this long pitch. This was, of course, also with time I discovered that you can use many different preparation together. So with the sax mouthpiece, it's very different what it does. Something that amazed me the first time I discovered it, and with time I managed to control it. So one other technique I didn't talk about before that is a common extended technique is to move the valves and to put them in the wrong way. Of course, never show it to your teacher or your trumpet repairman, he will go crazy. But so this, if I put it like this and do that, the sound doesn't pass anymore. But then if you remove it a little bit, the sound passes a little bit, and then it makes this weird fluctuation. So this you can do without water. And then once, totally by mistake, while doing this, I took the trumpet up, and something really weird happened with the sound. I played for a while, and then I couldn't believe. I emptied the water, put again water to see if it was really a one-time thing or if it was something I could control. And it ended up I could control this thing. So when I will do this now, I will send all the water in this third valve. When I put it up, don't ask me why, it will go all in this third valve. And then the water will block even more the passage of the sound. And then, yes, I let you hear it. Again, it's very weird sound. Sometimes I play really for 15 minutes, like a whole piece on this thing. The variations are endless, and the more, like, you really need to move a micromillimeter, and it changes, it blocks the sound more. Paradoxically, or the paradox of this thing, is that it's a very, very, very low volume sound, and it needs you to blow a lot to make this thing pass through the this very small passage. Again, it's very bad for your valve, so don't say I told you to do it. Talking about this, my trumpet was bent from here. You can still see it now. The trumpet repairman did a marvel. It was really bent like that, and I went to the trumpet repair and I said, "Yeah, can you repair it?" He said, "Did you, how did it happen? Did it fell?" I said, "No, I think it's where I was hitting it with a drum head." He said, you were what? I said I was hitting it with a drum head, and then he didn't ask, he just repaired it and yeah. So this is the culprit is here, yes, this drum head. Which brings us to So these, all these things were more or less this trumpet alteration I'm talking about. There are two other big things I use that are, yeah, trumpet preparation, or even I would say it's really a different instrument. By the way, when I record or play a solo or wherever I record, I put behind a trumpet, so I don't put trumpet and objects and the preparation, because somehow it's my revenge on not knowing how to play the trumpet, so I put trumpet and then people don't understand how this thing is happening. So yeah, this is a tune. I will play it with soprano sax. Also, it sounds, it looks really random, but again, I learned some things with years with the trumpet, things that probably you know from the beginning. For instance, this idea that this adds half a note, and then this is double this, and this is one, and this is, are these two together. Also, maybe it was 15 years after I played the trumpet that I know. But then I understood, okay, it makes sense, this, and then you double it, and then you, it's one and a half. Then with the tube, I decided to measure the trumpet and to have a tube that is the exact same length. I don't know if it changes anything, but I like to think of it as a scientific thing, like, yeah, I have the same length of tube as the trumpet, so. This alone sounds really like a bass clarinet. Not a very good one, but I mean, it's deep. So with this, what I discovered is, I have to say, by the way, that the idea of putting a tube came from Rajesh Mehta, who was playing 2 days ago. I don't know if you saw him. Rajesh plays a trumpet and then he puts a tube out of the second valve, and this tube goes to another trumpet, and when he presses the second valve, the sound goes from the other trumpet, and he does fantastic rhythmical pattern with it. I never heard him. Somebody gave me his CD when I was in Beirut, and I just saw this image of somebody with a tube connecting the two trumpets. I tried to play the same. I put a tube between two trumpets. It sounded like shit. I think Rajesh is fantastic to be able to manage these two things together. But the idea of the tube stayed, and I played it on the sax for a while, just to make it lower, to have a kind of cheap bass clarinet instead of buying one. And then one day I was playing it up like this, and I got the idea of putting something here, and then it began to vibrate, and then it was the opening of really a world that I still use today. So again, the trumpet is perfect for this because it is very directional. In the beginning I used to hate this, but for what I'm going to do with it, it's really very important. So I can play it like this. And then I can put most of these things you see here inside and create effects with it. These things also, it's very interesting to know, like I was saying before, like the most expensive one is for $1, I guess. But somehow it's almost more expensive than my trumpet, in the sense that if I break this one, I go to Schilke, I say I want a Schilke B3, and then it costs 2,000 or 3,000 euro, it's awful. But if I lose this, I don't know where to find it, or this tube, or whatever crap you find like this, I don't even know what to ask for if I want to buy another one. So it's mostly things that were amassed and found on the floor, took from my kids, from the kitchen, from anywhere, and it's really 20 years of amassing things, trying them and throwing them. This is, I talk about this because it's very dear to my heart. It's a bowl, salad bowl, plastic salad bowl. I don't know if you see it, but it has this lines here, probably to reinforce it. And during the 2006 war in Lebanon, they stopped doing them. And I ran off out of them, and then when they did them again, I bought 400 of these things. It costed $10, so 400, so it's not much. But unfortunately, they stopped again. I've been trying for 2 years to find, and I still have 5 of these things. So one day I will have to stop playing with this. I found many other, but the fact that it has this pattern here makes it really, really, really very weird. It makes very weird sounds. So first I use it just normally like this. Things that make this crazy sound. That don't ask me why. One day I put the comb and tried it, but it's these things that happen when you try many things. And this I couldn't find with any other load, and they break easily. So one thing here I could say is about how do I practice trumpet? Because I asked many friends, and they say, yeah, you should do 15 minutes, 20 minutes of breathing and long tones, and which I'm very bored because I don't feel the need of doing them. But I practice a lot, so how I practice is usually I say, okay, today I will play for 1 hour or 2 hours with the tube. And inevitably after 20 minutes I'm bored because I know everything, so I start to do other things. And so to arrive to something like this, I probably tried hundreds of other things. And then sometimes you find something, you grab it, and you feel there is potential in expanding it. Mm-hmm. It happened with all these things. And in the beginning, it was only things like this. So I would put them in. So have different... Sometimes you discover something beyond. So these boats, for instance, I got them for years and they don't sound that much. I mean, they don't sound any different from anything else. But then again, one day playing with other people, there is this crazy sound that also happened. So I have this bowl and I have some marbles in it. And then just to make, I make this gesture just to mute it. And then there is a sound that goes out. And also I say it's surely not this, it must be this with another musician playing that makes this crazy third sound. And it ends up that no, it's just this thing. I don't know what is the physical thing of this thing, but it makes a third sound. So. Uh, since, of course, there's a lot of chance in it, but there's a lot of try out and practice and throwing things that don't work. And there is, most importantly, the fact of being à l'écoute, you would say in French, like being aware and listening and waiting for something to happen and to grab it when it happens. Later with the thing, of course, it developed much more, and as I said, I stole many techniques from many dear percussionists. So I begin. One thing about that, actually, a trumpet player, a friend of mine, once told me a long time ago, he said, you know what you did to the trumpet? I said, no, what did I do? He said, you freed the hand of the trumpet player. And I never noticed before, but indeed I could play and have almost two free hands to do whatever else. I couldn't smoke like a guitar player because I have to blow, but I can do many things. So this idea really opened many things. So again, I put this here. Somebody asked me, why do I put it? It's not for the sound, it's just because when I put this like that, I don't see the trumpet, and it happens that this falls when I'm playing. So just a simple magnet. Also, I'm discovering very newly magnets. I talk about it later. So this is already. But then I can use it also as a drum and add stuff on it. So. This is a trick to stop breathing and do something else while this, the sound is still here. And so many other things are really only percussive. While I'm changing preparation, I can continue. The idea here is, Evan Parker used to say about the circular breathing that he was really pissed off by other musicians who can keep sound forever, so pianist or guitarist or even drummer or bass player. So this is what drove him to experiment with circular breathing. For me, I'm also pissed off by musicians who can make more than one sound on their instrument. So most instruments you can, of course, like a pianist could do many sounds. And this has been a quest for a long time, and I use it a lot in my music, especially in solo. I like this idea of putting one layer of sound and then adding another layer while this one is still working, and then a third one, and then remove the first one, and then add. It's really layering sounds, and I really find my music more, I would define it as something more horizontal rather than with shape. It's really something that unfolds in time and by layering stuff. So the more sounds I can make in the same time, the better it is. This goes for this infamous thing where I... this also to this friend who told me you liberated the hands. I saw him many years later. I told him I finally managed to liberate the legs also, so I can really have again many sounds, and I'm not blowing yet. Also this revolving marble, plus the percussive sounds that are added on the whole thing. I mean, all these things go, again, like this stupid toy took the time also to realize it could do the job while I'm doing something else. Or even this actually could. The marbles are the best friend of the musician, of the contemporary musician, of course. Because so all this permits so many things. And again, in this idea of always discovering stuff, what I discovered almost after 20 years of playing the trumpet with a tuba, or after 15 years, is something that I can't imagine I never thought about before. Again, things I discovered about the trumpet as an instrument, it's one of the rare, if not the only instrument that projects the sound in front of the musician. So the trumpet player never hears what the people who hear him are listening to. You always hear the sound from behind, which is really something very weird. So other instruments, guitar, bass, everything, like it's there. Even the trombone, it's closer to your ear. The trumpet, you really project, and I learned this because I used to play cornet for the longest period. When I turned back to trumpet again, the sound was so far from me, I felt like it was just that, but I already felt it's really far, and I realized how much we never hear. Of course, you hear the projection coming back, etc. But it took me time to just... So, to realize I could hear exactly what everybody is hearing. And again, this is because it's very directional, I can do this. And from there, of course, it was the open door for all kinds of effects. I'm sure of what I'm doing, but this idea of the trumpet being very directional also, I mean, it works with everything, so this idea of... because it is so limited somehow, the limitation I used to see in it, the fact that the sound comes from one source and it's really very directional, it can really be a very good friend of the trumpet player if you use it well. Since we have not much more time, I'd like to pass at least with this other instrument of mine, which is, so instead of the tube, it's this balloon, a stupid balloon. It has so many things. So this again, I always like to say I invented nothing. So with this I heard of a French trombone player who plays balloon on his trombone, who himself got it from Vinko Globokar, the composer. Vinko Globokar invented many, many great things, but usually he would invent it really for a piece and then it doesn't develop in something. Thierry Madiot, this French guy, really developed this idea. I never saw him, I just heard about it. Later on I saw him, but I just took the idea and said, okay, I want to play a balloon on the trumpet. And again, I used all kinds of things that I already have to develop the balloon. So you could do pitches on it. Of course, you can bend it very easily because it is the rubber. And you can use, maybe I make a last demonstration. It's very important for me to add this at the end because, again, it's a vocabulary that I invented or created or found. It's not important. The most important thing that I learned with time is that the vocabulary is useless if you don't have the grammar that goes with it. So finding new sounds, creating new sounds, listening and being inventive. I wouldn't say inventive, actually. What I think about it is really playful. And I love the idea that you play music because it's really playful for me. I wouldn't say I play tennis because it's very tiring, but I play music, so, and I like this idea of having it as toys and discovering and having this same things than a kid, where you discover toys or you discover drawing or whatever, and you are the first surprise of what it could do. So this is how I work, but it's very important, again, to have the grammar and to be able to play music at the end and not do sound effects, which is something else, of course, mm-hmm. and to be able to play music with others. So again, when I put the balloon in the beginning, I used to do one or two sounds with it. And then if you are playing with a group and then like I'm doing very loud sounds with the thing, and then they go in very quiet thing directly because it's improvised. Then, oh, I cannot with the balloon, I have to remove it and put something else, same with the tube. So with time, I really understood that if I want to play them, it has to be a very versatile new instrument. Once the balloon is here, I should be able to play with any situation that is thrown on me, and then I cannot just remove the balloon, put something else, and remove and put, and it's not intuitive, and and it becomes really a demonstration. So, yeah, today everything I was doing was a demonstration, of course. It's part of the deal today, but yeah, for those who saw it 2 days ago, I hope it was a good concert, but it was at least a concert, so trying to make sense out of all this. Yeah, thank you. If you have any question, please feel free. We still have a couple of minutes. How to destroy a cello, for instance. I have ideas for other instruments, if you want, please. Yes, what mouthpiece do you play? I have a 7C actually, I don't use it, I just put it here for when I meet a real trumpet player. I said, yeah, what do you use? And then we have this.
I'm curious about your discovery process. If you come across an object, do you set yourself up and say, oh, okay, today I'm going to discover this object? And
it's really about, yeah, it's about, like you said, it's the discovery of an object. So many times I'm, like my biggest toy store is the Bauhaus. You have Bauhaus, of course, in Essen, yeah, in Berlin, I go there, but I never tell them it's for music. So I say, do you have a tube like this thick? And I measured and everything. He said, yeah, and then we go, I said, no, not this one, thicker. And, yeah, this is it, how long do you want? I say, half a meter. And then he looks at me like, what do you want to do with the gardening hose? I said, yeah, it's for modeling or something.
Yeah.
Because when I tell them for music, it's a catastrophe. But it's really encounters with objects. So many times I look at an object, I say, wow, this would sound great as a mute. Mm-hmm. Then I bring it and it doesn't sound great. So it's always trial and error. Mm-hmm. And also looking a lot on other people. For instance, the propeller, the fan. Almost all guitar players at some point use this thing. And then as a guitar player, if you use this, you really has been like, oh, you still use a fan to do this. And for me, I always find it like great. It's, you don't have to do anything. You put it on the strings, and so for years I had fans with me, and I didn't know at all how to use them. It was really until one day I tried it on the balloon, and then I was amazed. But it was really for years I have it in somewhere. Same goes with many things, and I really look a lot again with the balloon. I look at techniques from double bassists a lot, and drummers. And funnily, in this music, I really like the idea that. What we use is really a common, for instance, five trumpet players meet, like what kind of mouthpiece do you use, or guitarists like, yeah, these strings or this amp. With improvisers, I could be with a drummer and a bass player and the pianist and say, hey, what kind of fork is this? Oh, it's from Lufthansa, it's very good, they don't break. And so we have really the same kind of accessories, and each one use it for different things. But yeah, for me, I'm always, like whenever I look at an object, it's either I might use it for drawing or for because in painting I did a workshop, a longer lecture where half of this I use them also for drawing purpose. So it's just this relation to the objects and to see how they do. And somehow since I never took myself seriously as a musician because I arrived really late, I was the first surprise that at some point, okay, I'm becoming a real musician, you know. My mom still don't believe they pay me money for what I do. After 25 years, she's amazed. Like, what? But I kept this, while with visual art, I'm more serious because I learned the right way. With this, I never learned the right way, so I feel totally free to go, yeah, wherever.
Do you write any of your music down, or do you pass it on through oral transmission? Does anybody else play your music?
not my music, and some people now finally, because I'm old enough, I begin to see younger people doing stuff inspired by what I do, by what I do, and I'm very happy. But my practice of music comes really deeply from improvisation, and I really believe in this self-portrait of the moment and the danger of improvisation and how it could go anywhere, and that most of the time it's okay and sometimes it's fantastic, and this fantastic is what we crave for, and sometimes it's shit, of course, it depends with whom you are playing, but I like a lot. But now lately I'm beginning to compose, but in a very weird way. It's very open composition, not for trumpet necessarily, but I'm questioning on how to write things or to make a conduction with live drawing for musicians. But for this, I don't feel the need because for me, the composition would be put a tube, put all this, and then go ahead and just see where, just follow the lead of the said object. Time to get a beer, yeah. All right, thank you everyone.
Somebody is doing something here.
No, you're okay.
Or good.